And good morning. We're doing good? Yeah, doing good. Not all those signs at play there are actually factually signs. The fact that one that says Free Methodist Church in front of the wigwam that points this way actually says Chamber of Commerce and points the other way. What oversight was that? We're over here. Doing pretty good. I don't have a lot myself tonight. We have a MOPS leadership meeting again on Tuesday. So if you have it help set up real quick after church, that's great. Those who usually help. anything else that needs to be mentioned? We have our usual Bible studies. Women's Bible study, Monday, 10 o'clock in this building. Thursday night Bible study, 7 o'clock in this building. Friday morning breakfast. Free breakfast, and we've been switching it up. We just finished a series on Christian modern day social things. We looked at fallen pastors. We looked at church decline in America. Next week, I know we're looking at a passage writing from C.S. Lewis. So again, mixing it up. Anything else needs to be mentioned? Well, awesome. Those at home, that was James, and he was thanking the church for praying for his mother. All right, let us set aside the cares of the world, focus on the Lord our God, sing praises to his name.
Test, hello. Good morning.
I'll give you glory for all you brought me through. Now I'm ready for whatever you wanna do. Moving forward, follow after you. Now I'm ready for whatever you wanna do. Your presence open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence. An open door, so come now, Lord, like never before. In every season, your grace has been enough. Now I'm believing the best is yet to come. The cross before me, my hope on things above. And in you, Jesus, the best is yet to come. Your presence is an open door. And we want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence. An open door, so come now, Lord, like never before. I know a breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and I won't stop now. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and I won't stop now. I know a breakthrough is coming by faith. I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and I won't stop now.
Please have a seat.
That is so good. I just love it here, you know? I just want to thank everybody for all the prayers that I hear coming up from this congregation. I've been going through kind of a tough time with my husband, my daughter, and what have you, the country in general. And I sat down and I talked to the Lord, and he made it clear to me, Twyla, you need a little bit more prayer. Actually, he said you need a lot more prayer. You need a lot more time in the Lord, in the Word. And so I've been reading Ecclesiastes again. And I would just encourage everybody during this time, this is a kind of a tough time in America, a tough time, that we all pray more, read more, praise God more, and remember who we are in Jesus more. Bow your heads with me, please. Really, Jesus, things are so clear when we hand them back to you. When we look at our Bibles and we know that 99% of anything we ever want to know is right there, tells us how to live, what to say, who to say it to. And I pray that today, as a church, as a congregation, as a people, that we would remember who we are in you, that we would pray for each other, laugh with each other, cry with each other when that's necessary, and love you, Lord, as we do today. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
You are holy. You are holy. Yeah. Holy. You are holy. King of kings, Lord of King of kings, Lord of lords, I worship you. King of kings, Lord of lords, I worship you.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect love, visions of rapture now burst on my soul. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Please have a seat.
Yeah, sorry about that. I was getting my Fijian and Tongan confused. Tongan is like fefehake, but Fijian is bula bula. For those, now you know. Now you know. This goes, things we've talked about over the last weeks, months, there is a, in the Bible, there's a recurring theme about, well, I like to call it the basics, you know, to hold fast to the things you were first taught type language. And today I'd like to look at a topic, not a particular passage, but a topic that is one of those recurring themes. And it revolves around one word. The word is faith. Faith. Looking to type faith in Google from Oxford Languages, it pulls up this complete trust or confidence in someone or something. Faith is complete trust or confidence in someone or something. This restores one's faith in politicians. I haven't heard anyone say that lately. In theory, it could be said. In theory. I haven't heard too many people say that. But number two, strong belief in God or in the doctrines of religion based on spiritual apprehension rather than proof. On faith as opposed to proof. Now, I don't know if I would word it quite that way, but and again, we'll look at it in our very next verse. which makes sense of that definition there. 2 Corinthians 5:7. For we live by faith, not by sight. Or we walk in faith, not by sight. From like King James, I've usually heard it quoted. We live by faith, not by sight. It means that there are certain things in the Christian realm that you just don't look at with your eyes. Now, some things are very clear and easy. We read through Proverbs, there's some very clear and easy things. It applied to life 3,000 years ago, still applies today, you know. Prayer is something. Now, prayer isn't done without certain evidences, but when you start off praying, you don't know what the Lord may say. You have hope and faith that, you know, things will work out the way you want them to, or you're praying for someone or their health. It's a good thing, but what if you're praying for something you don't know? A lost child. You haven't had contact with them for a long time. Might be some time before you ever know if that prayer was answered, you know, or longer. I think some of these things we might find out more evidence about them when we get to heaven, so to speak. But we live by faith, not by sight. So that does kind of fit what it was saying, based on spiritual apprehension rather than proof. So that by itself, that passage, for we live by faith, not by sight, I would say you quote that, and it could be what we'll call easy mode. You can say it. It's a simple phrase. I walk by faith, not by sight. You can say it, but can you do it? This is a strange human phenomenon that takes place in many people's lives. You can say something, but can you do it? Now, I personally, I don't, not you guys, you guys are probably towers of iron will, but there's been times in my life where I tell myself, I'm going to quit smoking. I said it to myself. I told myself, this is it. I said it, but could I do it? Okay, now, we're talking about some addictive substances. Nicotine, very addictive, and we know about other addictive substances. But there's other things that aren't quite as addictive, but still. I am going to cut back on eating. My pants don't fit. I said it. I meant it. And I had to go out and buy bigger pants. No, it's human. It's human. It's easy to say it, harder to do. Same could be said for, you know, silly. I gotta start going to bed early. I'm showing up late to work too much. I know people have lost their jobs because they said it, but couldn't do it. Well, the next one about faith is what I will call hard mode. So easy mode is just saying the phrase we live by, but harder to do it. The next passage requires you to do something. So this is Luke 17, starting off in verse 3. If your brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them, and if they repent, forgive them. Verse 14, even if they sin against you 7 times in a day and 7 times come back to you saying, I repent, you must forgive them. Well, now that's asking you to do something. That's going to be much harder to have that kind of faith. And look what the disciples, the apostles say in the very next verse, verse 5. The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. You know, if this is the way it's got to be, we're going to need some help. And I think that's a good reminder for all of us. We're going to need some prayer is an important thing of it, depending on the Lord to help you out. As you keep looking up this word, again, it's very easy to go to Hebrews chapter 11, and there's all sorts about faith. In fact, if you want some homework, read Hebrews chapter 11 when you get home. It's been widely used when talk about faith, so I'm skipping it today. Just because most people have heard it, know about it, or are about to read it this afternoon or whatever, Hebrews chapter 11. But Hebrews 14:31. This is the part where Jesus, walking on water, Peter gets out of the boat, starts walking on water, and he starts to sink like the rock he's named after. 14:31. Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. You of little faith, he said, why did you doubt? Now, I would say that the fact that Jesus says there's such a thing as little faith, I think we can understand there's also such a thing as people who have great faith. Great faith. If you ever read the journals of George Mueller of Bristol, did all the orphanages there, a German immigrant did all the orphanages there. His journals, I mean, just unbelievable stuff. You know, told Mrs. McNamara, whatever her name was, Mrs. Murphy, whatever it was, to prepare hot water for the children. There was no food. Prayed to the Lord for his deliverance, you know, his assistance, his provision. 5 o'clock. 5:03, potato cart overturns out front. You know what I mean? And this went on and on and on. Captain said we could not land, you know, 10:02. We're going to miss speaking engagements in New York or wherever it was, somewhere in the estate. 15 minutes later, after a time of prayer with the captain, the fog lifted, sailed. You know, I mean, this just goes on and on and on. Pray to Mr. So-and-so, they may be able to give us 10 pounds or whatever it was. Mr. So-and-so showed up and gave us 5 pounds. I rejoiced. The next day, Mr. So-and-so showed up and gave us 5 more pounds that he should have done it the day before. I mean, just stuff like that over. I mean, that's great faith. And he's seen it playing out before him. Twice, Hudson Taylor that I know of, who was a China Inland Mission, he's in China, is on his bare bones or waiting for some funds to show up. They haven't shown up yet. They're not expecting any more money. Things looking like, by the time it was over, China Inland Mission had like 80 different buildings they were running. Orphanages, schools, medical facilities. Amazing work. Hudson Taylor, the China Inland Mission. At some point, though, I think twice, a letter showed up unexpectedly with money in it. And it was from George Mueller. I mean, is that just the way faith and prayer and all these things work out? So, can there be little faith? Yes. But don't settle for that. You know. However, if we are going to grow in faith, there's probably some things you have to do. And this is what we'll look at. First, we're going to look at what not to do. We're looking at lack of faith. I find lack of faith disturbing. First, James 2:26. James, very, very popular passage on faith. James 2:26, as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. Now, he could have compared it to a lot of things. He compares it to the body without the spirit is dead. You know, depending on how long a person's dead, everyone knows. You know, there's not a lot of question involved. That person's been there for a while. They're starting to change color. You know, long time. They are dead. Right? It is over. I mean, you can't get any sicker than that. You know, that is the end of it. Well, he's making this faith is that. The end. Nothing left. If you don't have deeds with it. If you don't have works. Faith without works is dead. Well, that's just what we just saw. It's one thing to say I have faith, but it's another thing to actually live your life that way. And when it talks about works, it's works of faith. You do works of faith. There are, Jesus actually talks about giving, doing kind things and not letting anybody know. Just like God know. God knows. But no one's going to say, attaboy. No one's going to say, well done. No one's going to say, oh my gosh, you gave so much. And for some people, that's going to be hard faith right there, because they want to hear the kudos. They want to hear the congratulations. And I'm saying you shouldn't congratulate people once in a while. It's kind of a cold, dark world sometimes. A little attaboy once in a while can help you. But you're not supposed to be doing it for that reason. That's what the Pharisees did for the glamour of it all, the prestige. So that takes faith to just do things knowing God's watching, whether you get any credit for it or not. That would be a work. That would be something you could do, something tangible. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18. Timothy, my son, I'm giving you this command in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so that by recalling them you may fight the battle well. So he's telling them, I'm giving you this command in keeping with the prophecies made about you. As he was up and coming, Timothy, this younger man, his prodigy, and at this point he's on his own. He's actually, his job is to take care of problems in Ephesus. Same book, the book of Ephesians, same place. So, he's down there running things, trying to get things straightened out. I'm giving this command and keeping the prophecies once made about you, so that by recalling them, you may fight the battle well. There's going to be a struggle. It's going to be a fight, is the word used. It's not you're going to be inconvenienced. It might be a bit hot down there, but endure the temperature. Have a mint julep or something. No. He uses the word fight the battle. Now, he could have said other things, wrestle. Wrestle doesn't sound as bad as fight the battle. But he says fight the battle. And that, I don't care what picture of warfare, it is messy. Verse 19, he tells them, holding on to faith with a good conscience. It's a wonderful encouragement to them. Hold on to your faith with a good conscience, so there's a battle coming. Then look what it says. Which some have rejected and have so suffered shipwreck with regard to their faith. With regard to their faith, it's been shipwrecked. Now, what kind of picture does that draw to mind? Timbers snapping and cargo being lost and lives being lost, and just an empty hull of what once was a ship. But he's saying people are like that. So that same image would be a person who had some faith or something, but it says here, which some have rejected and have shipwrecked with regards to faith. They were doing okay, it looks like, and now they're just that crashed, empty hull of a ship on the shoreline decaying in the elements. That's where they ended up. So like I said, this lack of faith, that's clearly a don't do that part verse. Don't do that part. 1 Timothy chapter 4, a few passages later, he tells them, verse 1, the Spirit clearly says that in latter times some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. Now that's pretty powerful passage. It makes you wonder, makes you ponder. He's saying that as time goes on, people will abandon the faith. Again, faith is your personal trust and commitment, and overall, our faith in the Lord, our communal trust in the Lord. And he's saying people have abandoned it. Well, it sounds like they had it at some point, and then they let it go, abandoned. In fact, twice I've had to call the local deputies because there's been two abandoned cars parked in our parking lot out here, which is pretty crazy when you think about it. I believe both were stolen and left here. This was over the years. But out of all the places to dump a stolen car, why would you pick this church with its 9 paved parking spots and security cameras and leave the car? Happened twice. The cars were abandoned. And A lot of times they look like it. They've been taken for a joyride. They've been, you know, high-speed chases, who knows what. They look pretty rough. Same picture when they abandon the faith. What's left? Again, follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. What does that look like? I suggest modern times. The things people turn to when they leave Christ, anything goes. And they come up with some interesting things that just, you know, invent new ways to sin is a passage in the Bible. You know, and I mentioned, I do not have many fond childhood memories till the 70s. Right? I wasn't old enough to remember much till then. Right? I've grown up in a world where I've had, you know, more modern times, to, you know, by my standards. many women worked in the workplace by the time I was growing up. There was children in school who only had one parent. It wasn't that unusual, you know, to have kids with a key around their neck to get in and out of the house when they got home. And it was growing more and more as I went to school into the 80s, these trends. And so I wouldn't say that I was, you know, well, maybe liberal's a word for it, or certainly callous by the things I'd seen. And yet every now and then something new comes down where I'm a bit shocked. I raise an eyebrow and say, what are we doing? What are they doing? I mentioned this already. I was amazed this week at actually like, what? The Church of England has voted to take the name church out of their name. Huh? What are you following there? You're not following Christ. Now, do you have to have the name church in your name? No. It could be congregation. It could be assembly. It could be temple. There's churches with names like that. They don't have to say church. But the Church of England also mentioned, and they want to try to get it, and this was in the article I read, compare it to your own news reports, they wanted to get away from things like prayer and baptism and focus more on nature. Did not see that coming. You know, while I've seen a lot of things happen, didn't see that one coming, that just the entire nation's church would decide to change their name and switch gears, leaving Christ far behind. Makes me wonder that verse, abandon the faith. Abandon the faith. So, and we can go on. There's other passages to talk about. And we talked before about Corinthians. He kind of scolds them. He tells them, you guys are baby Christians. You're mere infants. And you should be more mature by now. It doesn't say when you start off, you might have some struggles with faith. It doesn't, you know, it's not saying that you're evil. It's not saying you can't be a baby Christian and mature. He's actually doesn't say there's anything wrong with being a baby. He's just saying by this time, you should be grown up. And we understand that, you know. A little two-year-old, you tell them to go clean the room, you walk in there, and they're either playing with a toy or falling asleep on it. That's kind of cute, you know. Your employee, you tell them to go clean up, and when they're playing, that's not cute anymore. Your 18-year-old, not cute anymore. So he expects us to grow. I'm not saying your faith can't grow. You have to be a superhero of the faith from the get-go. But there are some things you can do. Ephesians 6, very famous passage, the armor of God. He says, 6:16, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. So this faith now is in reference as a shield, which we still see some shields today. There's the riot shields police will use, and they're very handy. People are throwing rocks and bottles at them. Those plexiglass shields, very, very, very good idea during that time. I don't see anything wrong with it. Even face shields are wearing, and I have watched a few. I do watch car videos. I don't work on my cars like I used to. But I've seen some videos where things go flying this way and a grinding wheel splits and hot something welding snaps and pops. A shield is a good thing. I think of the movie 300 if you want to see some people who know how to use a shield, right? This is Sparta. So it's a shield. Now, it's saying that faith is like that. It is protection. It is part of your armor. It is stopping these fiery darts, fiery arrows from hitting you. What a wonderful thing to have at the right time, much like the plexiglass shield when the mob's throwing things at you. What a great device. Well, in this world, some things are going to be thrown at you. Here it's talking about fiery darts. That doesn't sound good. And wouldn't it be great to have a shield, the shield of faith? So one of the things we can look at, one of the more beneficial things, is faith is protection. Faith is protection. Jude chapter 1, verse 20, 21. But you, dear friends, by building yourselves up in the most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourself in God's love as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring you eternal life. A few things were said there. Building yourselves up in the most holy faith. It implies building, growing, and who's doing the work there? Yourselves. Some people have a problem when you talk about that. I'll mention that in a second here. You're putting too much effort into it. You're putting too much responsibility on the believer. I don't want to do that. But this, to me, I'm not talking about what the Methodist Church believes. I'm not talking about Mike. I'm saying you rest at the right now, you read this verse, and you come to the conclusion who he's asking to help build up their faith. He's telling them to do it. That's what I see. I can hear the voices, oh, let go, let God. I'm just saying, there's verses that tell you to get your stuff together. My parents used to say something along those lines. It was usually a time when I didn't have my stuff together. Build yourself up and pray in the Holy Spirit. There's something you can do. You can build up your faith. Well, how do I do that? Well, pray in the Holy Spirit. Keep yourself in God's love. There's something you can do as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring you to eternal life. Patience. Again, something you can do. Something you can get better at. Something you can use to build. Add to your arsenal. Add to your tool belt. When I was a younger man and tried to work on things around the house and my cars, I didn't have a lot of tools. And oftentimes you try to fix things with two screwdrivers, a pair of pliers, and a hammer. This is not the best way to go about it. For instance, screws, be it Phillips or Standard or some of the more other ones used, Torx and things, but we're talking about that's the most ones we see in the American here, the Phillips or the Standard. Those actually have different sizes. And if you only have one screwdriver of that particular one, it could be too wide, too thin, and you're stripping things. You're trying to fix something, but you don't have the tools. Why not put together a lovely Christian tool belt? In fact, if any of you ever seen the bag I carry around here to fix things, there is a cornucopia of tools in there. Just keep pulling them out, pulling them out. And you wait. You wait for Christ to bring you to eternal life. If you're going to wait on anything in this world, that'd be a great one. It has the most lasting repercussions. Romans 12, 12. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. There's that faithful word again, that trusting, that confidence in prayer. That's something you can do. And look what else you have to do there. Joyful in hope. Well, that's easy enough. That's one of those easy mode ones. I can do that. I can be joyful in hope. That's easy to say. Patient in affliction. Oh, that's harder. That's harder. I don't like to be inconvenienced, let alone afflicted. I want things to happen when I want them to happen. That will build faith. When you learn, I was patient. I didn't freak out. God took care of business. I was patient. I didn't stay up all night biting my nails. God worked things out. Life goes on. Does it come instantly? No, I think it can grow. I think you learn from experience. I've mentioned before, you can get to a place in your life where you've just seen God work so many times in the past, the next thing coming just doesn't bother you so much. Praise be his name. Patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Romans 10, 17. Consequently, faith comes through hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. So now you want your faith to grow? Comes here from hearing. What kind of hearing? The message is heard through the word about Christ, the gospel, the story of Jesus' life, the things he said. We can read what his followers said and how they taught all through the New Testament. So this is actually, we're talking about the basics. Not only is faith one of this, faith is all over the New Testament, which is confidence and trust in somebody, in our case, namely Christ. Should you take the name of church off your building and try to focus more on nature walks, who are you putting your faith in? Where is faith in that scenario? Faith comes through hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. So prayer can help, reading your Bible can help, remaining in God's love can help. And I've said this before, but I'll say it again. Doing those things that Christians have always done works. It helps. Do you want to ruin your faith? Then don't do those things. This isn't some hard-to-believe concept, right? I don't care what problem someone's having. Most of us who've been through it would ask some questions. Oh, I just don't have enough money to make food this week. You know, oh, okay, you know, I'll try to help you out, but what happened? You know, and you would, if it was a child, if it was someone you had a good rapport with, you know, where did your money go? Are you working? Why not? Are you looking for work? I don't mind helping you, but, you know, what's going on here? You would expect them to do some things. Do you budget your money? Do you save for a rainy day? Used to be, these were just wise things you'd expect people to do if they're trying to better their finances. In this world, in fact, I was watching a thing on economy, and income versus outgo versus high inflation, it gets harder. I'm not saying that you can always pull it off instantly. I'm not saying you just change your mind one day, but are you working at it? Or do you just buy what looks cool and then wonder why you don't have rent money next week? The reason I bring that up, before I moved to Fernley, I managed apartments in Reno to save up money for a down payment on my little house. I managed apartments for like 2.5 years. The first complex had 48 units, and the next one, but they were singles. And the next one had 32 apartments, and they were families. So each month, and of course, those were two apartment complexes that faced each other. Well, you knew everybody's business. You could tell when they came, when they go, if their kids were well-behaved, if they weren't. There was a lot of those. You know, whether they were being free-ranged out there in the parking lot. You know, all these things. You could see it all. You could see it all. And I'm not exaggerating. Somebody would walk past me with this massive cases of beer and tell me I can't make rent this month. I'm not saying you can't have a brewski, but if you can't pay your rent, maybe you want to cut back on some of the brews there, you know? If you, you know, you might have to go with some of the lesser favorite brands or whatever, you know, just things you can do, right? You would ask us, this is no different with Christianity. Your faith is stumbling, you're having a hard time. Well, what are you doing? So now we come back to that problem. I can hear the voices. You need to let go and let God. You're putting too much effort on people. You're expecting them to provide their own salvation. I realize you could draw that conclusion from talking about a person's responsibility. Look at this next verse, Luke 17, verse 10. So you also, when you've done everything you were told to do, should say, we're only unworthy servants. We've only done our duty. Right? They were servants, maybe slaves. They were just doing what they were told to do some things. What special bonus points do you get if you're doing what you were told? You know? In your time in the army, if you're out there marching or drilling or, you know, does a general come by and go, oh my gosh, you showed up today. That's awesome. I can't believe you're out here doing this. That's just great. Not going to happen. Why? Because you're doing what you're supposed to be doing. Same with employees at work. Oh, you showed up on time and you went to your desk? Well, that's just great. Maybe you should take the rest of the day off. I can't believe you showed up. What if you went to the boss or the general or the whatever? Hey, boss, I showed up on time. Yeah. Oh, and I sat up and I did my, yeah. And I'm planning to stay here all day. Yeah, you're supposed to do that. So let's look back at that verse again, Luke 17:10. So you also, again, who's it talking to? When you have done everything you were told to do, is there something you're supposed to do? Yes, what you were told. How do we know what that is? Read the Bible. We're only unworthy servants. We have only done our duty. So to me, I don't have a problem reading in the Bible. There's some things we can do. There's some things we can do to increase our faith, to better our chances. Again, I don't think everything's easy. I don't. I don't think finance are easy. I don't think your personal health is easy. You know, I just can't lose weight. We would ask some questions, you know. Well, I saw you at the buffet last night. That's probably not the best place to start, you know. You have a gym membership? No. If they say yes, then ask them if they go. I have a gym membership, been there once. I hear it's nice. You ask these questions. So I don't think there's anything wrong with in Christianity looking at some of these things. We're talking about faith, which is all over the Bible. All over the Bible. Why not look into it, work at it, flesh it out, figure out what's, you know, take personal inventory on how you're doing. Again, you know, I'm not saying superhero, but look back. Have you gained any ground? You know, you have to step on the scale once in a while to see if you've lost some weight. Similar in Christianity. And look what Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4. This is believed to be at the end of the apostle's life. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. There's a guy who's looking back over his life. He knows the time for his departure is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished a race. To me, that sounds like it was involved. There was some effort applied. And he kept the faith. And he's looking for that glorious day. Glorious day. Funny thing is, I'm going through these verses and moving around and thinking about things. A song came to my mind. I hadn't thought about this song in quite some time. In fact, I knew it was from way back when, but I wasn't sure how far back. I'm not talking about the 1800s or anything, but in my Christian walk. It was a modern song, but years ago. So does anybody remember the group For Him? A couple nods. That's about it. For Him was the name of men singers and beautiful harmonies and things like that, For Him. And they had this song called Where There Is Faith. Where There Is Faith. And that song and the words were coming back to me. I hadn't thought about it a long time. I hadn't heard it in who knows when. And unfortunately, something's happened where a good Christian song doesn't stay on top as long as it used to. Why? Well, because it used to be radio play and the radio stations would carry things, you know. But as the internet came along, great songs can come along much quicker, spread much faster, and die out much sooner because a new batch is coming along. This song spent 8 weeks in the top billboards of Christian charts. This group had 3 Dove Awards, the Christian Version Award there. And it says this, I believe in faithfulness. I believe in giving of myself for someone else. I believe in peace and love. I believe in honesty and trust, but that's not enough. For all that I believe may never change the way it is unless I believe Jesus lives. So you can have these good things, but leave out Jesus. Anyone from the Church of England watching? That one's for you. The next chorus says, there's a man across the sea, never heard the sound of freedom ring, only in his dreams. I can see that. You know, watch the news of foreign nations and things. There's some rough times out there, rough countries to live in. There's a lady dressed in black in a motorcade of Cadillacs. Daddy's not coming back. And it says, as our hearts begin to fall, as our stability grows weak, but Jesus meets our needs if only we believe. And when you think of the word belief, think of the word trust, faith. And the chorus says this, where there is faith, there is a voice calling, keep walking. You're not alone in this world. Many people need to hear this in times of despair. You're not alone. Where there is faith, there is peace like a child sleeping. Oh, the imagery. Peace like a child sleeping. Hope everlasting. And he who is able to bear every burden, to heal every hurt in my heart. It adds, it is a wonderful, powerful place where there is faith. I hope that what happened to me there happens to you too. That old songs or verses come back at the right time. Bits and pieces of your dusty brain, you know, get cleaned off and you remember these things. Powerful song. May you remember psalms and songs and hymns. Some of us may not be able to hit all the notes, but the words can strike a chord in your hearts. May we remember God's word, because faith comes through hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, I thank you for this time, this hour, this time of worship, this time of fellowship, this time of community. May we encourage one another. May our faith grow. May we stand on that day and hear those words, Well done, good and faithful servant. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed. Hold on, sign the card. Sign the card before you go. Okay, sign the card.